Hello, friends. How are you doing today? Thank you so much for joining me for another bonus lesson for ukulele players. Really appreciate your support on Patreon, and I hope that you're having a good day, whether you're watching this live or as a replay. Wishing you well. Today is going to be a really fun session. This is the bonus lesson for April 2023. This is for patrons who are at the $10 membership tier or higher. And today is going to be the Steen show, because we're going to be playing a song from Rodgers and Hammerstein and Bruce Springsteen. I know it's Rodgers and Hammerstein, but I couldn't resist the pun. Rodgers and Hammerstein and Bruce Springsteen. We're also going to be hanging out with the key of D major. Glad that you're joining me for this session. I'm going to use my new high-tech setup to zoom in on this board. There's a little bit of glare there. Nothing I can do about that right now. And we'll also be zooming in close to my hands, showing you exactly how to master the riff for Bruce Springsteen's Glory Days. We're going to get into the famous Do a Deer from The Sound of Music, and a whole lot more, including your questions. So thanks so much for joining me. I hope that your ukulele is in tune. We have a bunch of stuff to cover in this hour, so let's jump right in. Hope that you have downloaded the music sheets for you. They are at the patron post. And before we jump in, real quick, if you are coming to the Salt Lake City area in 2 weeks, I'm going to be getting on a plane and presenting an all-day immersion class. There's a concert that follows, and this will be my first gig that I fly to since before the pandemic lockdown. So I'm really excited about coming back to Salt Lake City. And if you'd like to join me for a five-day immersion class, I'll be at the amazing Omega Institute. It's part of their Arts Week. There are many different artists on staff. You can drop into other classes. The Omega Institute offers daily yoga and movement classes. And the program that I'm going to be offering is, of course, centered on learning music and the ukulele. But we also go deep into mindfulness practices, ways of making your learning more focused, more joyful. It's a very fun and creative time at the Omega Institute. There are links to that at my website, stufuchs.com. Just click on the calendar at stufuchs.com. All right, friends, let's jump right into the lesson. You can see right here is the first of two worksheets. We have the D major scale and a famous melody of Do, Re, Mi. Now, scales are a wonderful thing to practice. Highly recommend that you spend some time each day practicing your scales. It doesn't have to be a very lengthy or even complex process. And I'm going to show you how to go through it first, exercising the mechanics of scales and then getting musical with it with some basic improv games. And then we'll jump into Sound of Music, Do a Deer. So let's start with our fretting of the scale. So that's one octave of a movable D major scale. Now, as we play this, let's begin by placing our index finger on the root note, okay? That's the note right here, second fret of the C string. Then our ring finger comes here to the fourth fret of the third string. Finger moves across, second fret of the second string, third fret of the third string, fifth fret of the second string. Moving across, second fret, fourth fret, and we are home. And then we descend. Pinky, ring finger at the fourth fret, index finger at the second fret, pinky moving to the fifth fret, second string, middle finger, third fret, index finger, second fret, ring finger at the fourth fret, and then we're home to do. Now, at first, our mission is just to make a clear, connected sound with as little tension as possible in the hand. So I recommend that you hold the ukulele in such a way where, especially if you have a strap, it's great. You can just relax. Your hand is doing nothing to hold up the instrument. And just play one note and then lift up the pressure and get a muffled note. So right now my finger is completely dead weight on the string. And as you do that, you may like to just check in with your wrist. Is it soft? Because that's the whole point, is to program a soft touch into your fingers. So you play and then you release. Notice how my wrist is straight. It's not bent out that way or curled back this way. This alone is a big victory, okay? And this is the crux of what we're doing. If we took the ukulele away, it's like our fingers are just making an okay sign, right? They're just touching in a very natural way. There just happens to be some strings in between your thumb and your index. Okay, now go to this. Ring finger. And then index. And then the second finger. So you see how we're memorizing the pattern, and we're doing it in a way where we're programming a relaxed touch into our approach. So glad you're here. I see there are 25 people already in the room. Thanks for spending some time with me. This video will be here for you to watch as many times as you want, okay? This is, of course, the monthly bonus lesson to be a friendly, helpful guide for you. Now, I'm just going to change the camera angle here for a moment so you can see. Whoops. Hello. There is the pattern, okay? We have the root note, D, is filled in, and it's filled in here as well. Now, you'll notice that there are also some open strings you could use, okay? The note right here at the fourth fret of the third string is an E, and it's also found as an open string. And the note at the fifth fret of the second string is also right here as an open string. So you can use the open strings. If you do not use the open strings, though, there is a cool thing that you can do, and that is to move this to other positions. So just watch me, please. We're going to work it out in a minute, but just watch how now I... up. I'm picking with my thumb, but you could use a pick. You could use your two fingers. The point is to start to focus on the smooth touch of the left hand and the smooth connection of each note. You ready to dig in? Come on, friends. Let's do this. What we're going to do, we're going to hang out. This is it in tablature right here. Okay. This is it in the visual notation, okay? So let's do the best we can just to make a smooth, continuous, just buttery, connected sound. That's gonna be all about the timing of your left hand, okay? Let's go up and down the scale slowly. One, two, three, four. Next note. Next note. Next note. Again, descending the scale. Hold on to each note. Yes, and then right here, we have another leading tone, okay, one note below. Okay, and I hope that this is helpful, this visual reference for you. Let me zoom in on my hand a little bit more so you can really see clearly what we're doing. The smooth connected sound is going to be determined by the connection this hand telling this hand when to pick, okay? So this time we'll do quarter notes. Those were half notes. One, two, three, four. Now we're gonna do quarter notes, okay? Are you ready? One, two, three, and. And then back down. If you are new to scales, please set this as a goal, just this simple goal, okay? This is your action item for this month. Would just be to be able to smoothly move the hand and make a clear, connected sound. Notice it's different than this, where each note is separated, okay? That's staccato, and staccato separated sounds are great. They also are easy to do on the instrument because we tend to grab at the note and squeeze and release. See if you can cultivate the opposite end of the spectrum, the legato, okay? The smooth, connected sound. And that's going to be a process of you really settling in and just taking your time. So do this just for like 3 minutes. Literally put a timer on your phone, okay? And just and just listen to the smooth connection of the notes. As you practice, if there's any tension in the hand, like right there, stop. And just let go. Some folks shake out the hand. I understand the value of that, but see if you can just let it go, softening up, okay? Sometimes when we shake the hand, we can shock it, all right? So you may like to stretch it a little bit, but soften it, okay? So that's your goal for this week, friends. Are you up for it? Let me know in the chat if you're up for this goal. Once you master this scale, guess what? You can start to really jam on it, all right? So what we're going to do is we're going to put on a little drum machine here. All right. One, let's first move up and down the scale just plainly. Let go. Working it out. Come on now. Dennis, glad you're up for it, man. You're gonna get it. Feel the hands softening, getting stronger each day. All right, then let's just, you could then turn on a metronome and work out your eighth notes, your triplets, your 16th notes, and so on and so on. But let's just let that go for a little while, and let's instead practice in a playful way. And what do I mean by that? We're gonna make simple melodies. Watch me for a moment. Just watch and take this in. I'm gonna make very simple, simple phrases. A phrase is a couple of notes and then some silence, okay? You punctuate your ideas with either full stop periods or commas or even question marks, okay? Just listen to me play for a minute. These are gonna be simple phrases, okay? This is playful, so use the corners of your mouth when you try this. Here we go. One, two, watch me, please. So what I did there was I took a simple phrase of three notes and I'm adding rhythm. Okay, so just like we are always talking in rhythm, da-da-da-da-da-da, talking in rhythm, we want to make our instrument speak. How do you know you've made a clear phrase? When you can repeat it with your voice. You don't have to sing it perfectly in tune, but you may like to go like this. Just play a little phrase and then sing it back. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. All right, so this means your practice, and we're gonna just let it flow now, and you're gonna jam with me. The last thing I'll say is that let this be a process where you are really taking some breaks, you're relaxing your hand, you're making sure that your ideas are clear, easily understood, and this is different than just noodling. You're literally composing now, okay? You're not just noodling and rambling on, you're composing. Are you ready? All right, let's put on that drum machine. Here we go. Flow. Let's have some fun. Let's do this for 2 minutes. Here we go. Put some space in your phrase. Simple. Rhythm. Notice if you repeat, you get a phrase, you get a theme. All right, so try this game of repeat it. Repeat it two or three times and then end the story with something different. You ready? Make something simple, repeat it. Repeat again. Come on now. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, octave. Octave, seven, six, five, four, three, two. Now two times each note. Just work it out. Let go, take a break, my friends. How you feeling? You good? Now, we could do this for this entire lesson, and someday we will just improvise. I want you to really entertain the idea that improvisation is not complex. You're already improvising, you know? You're improvising every day of your life. So when we come to music, treat it the same way you learned to speak. At first, we're like children, like toddlers, just babbling out simple phrases. You get mastery over those phrases. Then begin to create stories with your phrases. Keep it very, very simple. Simple enough that you could sing it back, okay? In time, yes, it gets more complex. This is a different game than I'm gonna practice my scales in every position, every possible rhythmic permutation, and then I'll know how to make some stuff up. There's a different way to work. That is a wonderful way to work as well, but this is giving you full bore permission just to go ahead and explore. Now, last thing, when you do this, when you practice your scale, start to pay attention to when you play with rhythm, in this case, this drum track, maybe you do it with your metronome or whatever you use as a jam track. Start to pay attention to, are my phrases starting on the downbeat? Are they starting in between beats? Let me show you what I mean. One, two. This is on the beat. On the beat. Off the beat. Off. Let me demonstrate by counting. Count with me. One. See, I started on the beat. Four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. You see how my phrase started in between one and two. I'm just gonna do my thing, watch what happens. Okay, so I'm just jamming there for a little bit. And yeah, I'm using different positions and different, you know, skills that I've developed. But use first, just start by using this simple pattern. You'll develop the technique to play scales with a clean, smooth tone, and then just go forth and jam. All right, questions, please. Ask your questions in the chat. Put a bunch of question marks before and after your questions so I can really see it pop out of the chat. I appreciate you joining me. We're going to jump into the other part of this lesson, which would be learning the melody for Do a Deer. And I'm glad you're here from the Netherlands. Dank je wel. Appreciate you coming. I can't wait to get back to the Netherlands someday. David is in the house from the UK. So glad you're here. Brighton's in the house. Edmonton's in the house. Thank you, friends. Thank you for joining me. Now, if there are no questions, let me just end that section by saying, watch this again for a reminder, okay? And then just practice this a little bit each day. And you'll see your skills at making up phrases will grow. They really, really will grow. Especially when we get specific melodies under our fingers, it becomes our vocabulary. Let's learn Do a Deer, okay? Nice and slow. One, two, three, nice and slowly. All from the major scale. Second to last line. Do a deer, a female deer, ray a drop of golden sun. Me, my name, I call myself, far, a long, long way to roam. Right here. La, a note to follow, so tea, a drink with jam and bread, that will bring us back to do, 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 do. All right, so this is a good workout for playing your scale. It gives you vocabulary. This is a brilliant song. I know you already know that. But what an awesome song for learning music theory. Julie Andrews fans in the house. So these notes, of course, they're named for the pitches, D, E, F sharp, G, A, B, C sharp, D. They're also given numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And without getting into too much of a music theory lesson, something I'd love to do, of course, they also have names in the Western system, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti, and then back to Do. Every chord has every scale step has a particular chord that can be built upon, okay? D major, then E minor, F sharp minor, etc. And so this is the way a major key is structured. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. And when you know the notes to sing, you can sing most anything. Okay, as Julie Andrews sang in The Sound of Music. Now, I'd like to take you through the chords now. You can practice this on your own. The chords for this are right here, okay? This is just something very quick I pulled from the internet. Someday I'll make a cleaner version of it. But for now, let's just play our chords. We have our D major chord. Do, a dear. Sing with me, please. We'll do it slow, and then we'll add some rhythm. Do, a dear. A female deer, A7, ray a drop of golden sun, D, me my name, I call myself, it says A9, just play A7, fa, a long, long way to run. Now we're going to change from D to D7, so, a needle pulling thread, E7, la, a note to follow, so, A major. Now we're moving to F sharp 7, which is played like this. 3-4-2-4. T, a jink with jam, and B minor, bread. You have that bar there, all you do is go to D7. That will bring us. E minor 7 is a same fingering as a G major chord without the ring finger. Bring us back to do, 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 do. Okay. So that is, in a nutshell, we don't need that last line there. In a nutshell, that is the harmonic structure for the melody that we were just playing. Now, friends, let's go through it one more time. This time with a little bit of groove. F sharp 7 may not be a very familiar chord to some folks, so check it out. Play your F. F major, your good old F major chord. Drop your ring finger and your pinky, and you have an F 7. Move it up one fret. F sharp 7. Just like we were practicing the scales, relax. Just make a thudded sound, a muffled sound, so you can really train yourself to relax and train that wrist to be straight without any tension in the thumb, or at least with less tension in the thumb. Okay, your fingers will start to get stronger as this relaxes at the same time. And then we move to our B minor. Okay? So there's a lot of harmonic motion in this song, and yet it still is in the key of D. Let's play together. We'll do it nice and gentle. One, two, one, two, three. Do, a deer, a female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, my name, I call myself. Far, a long, long way to run. So, a needle pulling thread. La, a note to follow. So, tea, a jink with jam and bread. That will bring us back to do, 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 do. Okay, so you can add these chords to the other sheet that we were playing with. Now, let me know if there are any questions about this. I will add a few extra things to the post this, or you can just take a screenshot of this. Someday I will make a cleaner version of that song sheet. But there it is, Do Re Mi, the Do A Deer, famous song from The Sound of Music. So I want to, of course, jam out the next song, which is going to be Glory Days by Bruce Springsteen. It's in the same key as the original recording, so you can play along with your CD or, you know, put on Glory Days from Bruce Springsteen. You'll be able to jam right along with it. But before we do this, I want to answer some questions, and not only from you live, but those who have submitted questions in advance, okay? Please let me know if you have any questions about what we did. That was, of course, just a brief but hopefully potent journey into playing a scale technique of how you can really relax and make your hand soften so you get a smooth sound. And yes, it takes time, of course. If you just spend 5 minutes a day just making the sweetest sound you can, you'll see 6 or 7 days a week practicing this just for a few minutes a day will really bring results, okay? So I hope you stick with it because scales are not only the gateways to improvisation and playing lead, but they make your hand very fit, okay? They really make your hand healthy. All right. So, Fred Zelder's in the house. Glad to have you here, man. So we have a question from Gordon, who I believe is in the house from Edmonton. He's been playing ukulele for 8 years. And his question says, singing, how do you determine what is a good key for one to sing in? We're jamming in Maui a couple of weeks ago, and one of the good singers really wanted us to play in A major, but none of us could transpose on the fly. Most of our music was in C, G, or F major. We had 5 ukuleles and another 15 singing. Too much fun at that extended happy hour. Cool, sounds like you were in a good spot in Maui playing your ukulele. How perfect is that? So as far as what key to sing in, there are many variables. What is your natural range? Well, it depends on, are you a very tall person? What is your build? Larger men tend, taller men tend to be, a deeper voice. And as we are smaller framed, we tend to have a higher pitch. The keys that are comfortable for men are different than keys that are comfortable for women. Now, I'm no expert on finding what key you're comfortable in, but I do know that applying some of the singing exercises that I've been sharing for the last couple of months will really help. So you may like to begin with the low notes, okay? And I go over this in one of the singing exercises where we are really training ourselves to open up the bottom of our range. It roots us and it allows us, it gives us roots, not just metaphorically like the tree growing out of the roots, but it really will allow your voice to blossom. So I would say, sing along with your ukulele. You'll probably sing, if you're a guy, you'll probably sing of an octave below. Oh. You see, that's the exact pitch. And I'm singing in falsetto to make it the same pitch. That would be up. So try singing along with your uke, and a good thing to do is just take a moment to listen to the note and then sing. If you're comfortable with that, you can sing and play at the same time. So you'll determine your range by going to your instrument, and if you have a keyboard or access to a keyboard, then you'll of course have more notes to play with. Okay, so I hope that helps. Keep on exploring, Gordon. You're gonna find your range, and then that will determine what keys you're comfortable in singing in. Got a question from Jennifer. By the way, if you're watching live, please put your questions in the chat, and then we're gonna get into the second part of the lesson. Jennifer writes, can you please give us some tips for playing bar chords like the G9 chord? I know what you're going to ask. We talked about this. Where the middle finger bars. Yes, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about the James Brown chord. I got a little guitar here, so let me demonstrate on it. Thank you. So this barring several strings, either with your ring or your middle finger, can be tricky. I love my little gitalele. It's very fun. So, Jennifer, let's get into some practical stuff for you and for everybody. What I'm calling the James Brown chord is a ninth chord. It's found in a lot of famous funk tunes. And what you're remembering was what we did in that lesson, chord solo lesson, where this chord is being played. Now, you can play it with four fingers, or you can play with the bar, or like that. So you're looking for tips on this. First, I want to give you a musical context. Let's play right here, fret 4, fret 5, fret 5, fret 5. Let's do it just four finger style. This chord is a B minor 7, flat 5. It's also a D minor 6. Okay. And it's also a G9. So getting deep into the music theory stuff here. There are three applications of this one collection of notes. Okay. Let's call it a G9. G9. What it is taking this G7 shape. Remember earlier in this lesson, we had this shape, F7, F sharp 7, G7. And now what we're going to do is this note, the root note, is going to be moved up two frets. And it's a different color. Okay, it's a dominant seventh chord with a ninth. Okay, and then after that, we'll go home to C. So here, G9. Okay, just a simple chord progression so we can apply it. So just to review, we have this F shape. Drop the ring finger, drop the pinky to get your F7. This is one of four movable dominant seventh shapes. Right there. You've come across this chord, I'm sure, especially if you've been following my lessons. This is a very common application, the other G7, sometimes it's called. Then what we're going to do is we're going to place our index finger here and straight across the fifth fret. And then back home to C. Okay. You could also make it more colorful by moving up to C6, 5, 7, 5, 7. Okay, I'm answering these questions on the fly, otherwise I would have graphics for you. Now Jennifer's asking, what happens when you play it like this? All right, with these two fingers. Well, what happens is you freed up a lot of fingers. You can decorate it. Yeah, this is much more advanced kind of stuff. It's for jazz and other applications. Now, please don't hurt your finger, friends. But what you can do is you can start to explore bending the knuckle just a little bit this way. And I'm not forcing it. I'm really not. And to be honest with you, I had an injury to this knuckle when I was doing some housework a few months ago, and it's finally feeling better. So I'm being very tender with my fingers. Very, very gentle, okay? But the goal is, if you just do this just for a minute, soften up and get some more flexibility in those knuckles, what you're going to find is you're going to develop the ability to cover two strings with what's sometimes called a hinge bar. It looks like a door hinge, right? All right. So the first hinge bar, right there. And you can... That's a very beautiful chord, the C6-9 chord. And then, Jennifer, as we move up to the G9 shape. What you do is you plop this down up one string. And you can see that there's even more of an angle, but I'm connecting. Everybody's going to feel it a little differently. I'm connecting with that first string just under the knuckle. And I'm not really trying to touch the tip of this finger to the note. It's a little different than if you're fretting, where I'm using the tip of the finger to fret. Here, it's more like that. Okay, you can see that I'm actually touching. I'll rub it so you can see. I'm touching quite a ways down on the finger. Okay, but that's just me and my hand. You know, you find what works for you. But in general, after teaching people for a long, long time, that we want to not be using the tip of the finger. It's more just the underside right there. Now this, you might wonder, well, why are you spending the time on this? Why not just use four fingers? And if you're comfortable doing that, that's fine. But in the long run, it's actually easier to just have two fingers. We just have to be able to hinge it and keep it very, very light. Last thing I will say about this is that, just like before, just let the fingers flop on the strings and get them comfortable in that position, then push. And even if you have a few buzzes in there, that just means that you're still staying pretty relaxed. And then break often. Please do not, all caps, do not just sit there and keep squeezing. Let the hand go. And then do it again. All right, I hope that's helpful. In time, you will really get strength and the ability to let go quickly, which punctuates the rhythm. See, I'm letting go. That's that jazzy style of playing. Relax the hand. You find that in reggae as well. All right, last question that was submitted in advance. When you are creating a chord melody arrangement, this is from David Dong. When you're creating a chord melody arrangement, what factors do you consider when choosing what key, high or low G? It really depends. I'm just giving a brief example of a solo that actually I haven't played in a while. Thank you. I'm glad it came out of my fingers. And to answer your question, David, I find, well, first part of your question, G or low, high G or low G, I like both. So unless I need these low strings, I absolutely need those notes or a richer texture, I'll sometimes try it on a high and a low G and just see what feels best and what sounds best to me. And so that's either or for me. The other thing I'll do is I'll take a look at the melody and find out, does the melody note line up, the top of the chords line up with where the melody is? So in this case, for I can help. Okay, so right there, that's where I started to figure this out. I was playing the song and I realized, hey, wait a minute. That section of the song that everybody knows, it's the title of the song, is the note A, B, and C. So I got thinking, wait a minute, if it's an A and the chord on the chord chart says F, then there we go, there's my chord melody. The next melody note was right here, and the chord chart says G, or G7. Then right there I have my chord melody. The next chord is A minor. Ah, but wait, I need this note on top of the A minor chord. And that note C is part of A minor. It is included in A minor. Right, so what I'm doing is I'm playing all notes that are inside the chord. Okay, they are chord tones. They're not non-chord tones. They are chord tones. Then, of course, once I block that out, then I can use different rhythms. I might emphasize the melody and then back it up with a little rhythm. All right, you could do different textures. See, I'm just using a little finger style, but making sure that melody is very clear and in the foreground. Now. Okay, now is the rest of it. So, falling in love. I know that that's the top of a C chord. With, I know that this is the top of a G7 chord. And then C. So, it is a complex game. It starts to get complex. But luckily, many songs, the melody are chord tones. Okay? So, that is what I would recommend. When you start to make chord melody arrangements, get very clear on where the melody is, get clear on whether that melody is part of a chord. You may have to play a different voicing of a chord. And then you find creative ways to make the chord and the melody happen at the same time. All right, friends. Great questions. Come on, let's jam a little bit of this song, Glory Days. Now, the riff is actually really easy to play. Okay, check it out. Let me get this going on in here. Okay, so it's A. Play it for you right here. Let's listen to Bruce here for a sec. Here it comes. So that is a very straight up rock and roll riff, not hard. Check it out. A, drop your ring finger, take it off. Okay, that's A to A, sus 4 to A. The next chord, play your D. I like to use one finger. You can use all three if you like, or you may like to use a hybrid where you use one finger for the bottom strings and then this one is at the second string. Notice on that diagram there, you see those X's on the top line of tablature? It's because we don't want that string to ring. We want the melody to be. All right, so I hold the D major chord in such a way where that top string is muted. All right. Next, the arrows, okay? There's a down arrow here because I'm going down with my thumb. And then up, up, down, down. Then I move. move to D. Down, up, up, down, down. As you can see, I'm bringing it down very slowly. That's how I recommend everybody do everything. If you're willing to stay slow just a little longer than what your mind wants to rush ahead and just get it, if you hang with it a little longer, you'll actually retain it longer and you'll get clarity on what you're learning. As soon as you feel a click, put the beat to it. One, two, let's try it. Here we go. Okay. Now, the top D string, the top D chord, if that top note rings out, it's no big deal. But it's sometimes the riff can be clearer that way. I'm barring with my index finger. Okay. If you move it up two frets, you get an E. And this comes in later in the song, a very brief instrumental break. Then it goes back to D. 1, 2, 3 on E. Woo! Okay. If you haven't heard the song in a while, go listen to Bruce. There is that breakdown there. Okay, come on, friends. Let's just jam it. Have a good time playing along with the song itself. Okay, I'm gonna plug this in and hope that the sound is not too loud for you. Appreciate you joining in. Now this is at 120 beats a minute, and here comes the band. Excuse me, friends. Technical difficulties. Please stand by. All right, here we go. Keep that riff going. Here we go. Stuff. Let me stop for one sec because you're probably wondering. Awesome jamming. I hope you are having a good time. So you can use this riff throughout the entire verse if you like. You could just keep it going or just strum in any way that feels comfortable to you. I had a friend was a big baseball player back in high school. Or just play. My friend was a big baseball player back in high school. What strum am I playing? Really anything that keeps the beat. I like to encourage players to, of course, learn specific patterns, but to also feel a certain freedom, you know, to embellish it the way you like. The good old down, down, up, up, down strum will work fantastic, and you can decorate it with some fan strokes at the beginning. Or you could just play down, down, up, up, down. Okay, if you want to make it sound a little more, it's a little more intermediate level to keep that riff going. and I'm muting and putting a little bit of... Okay, so don't want to over-explain it, but I just wanted to clarify that you have the option of doing whatever you like. Last, anytime you come to this section, like with the E7 chord, there's really no riff. We're just playing the chord, right? And I changed my strum at the very end. But all he kept talking about, just a simple buildup, all downstrokes. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and boom. Okay? The kind of thing that I'm sure you can feel very intuitively, right? A crescendo. Right, a little bit of buildup to a climax before we hand it off to the chorus. All right, let's go back a little bit, and then we're going to take it from verse 2, and we'll just keep on jamming. Are you having a good time? I appreciate you joining in. Here we go. Here we go. Just keeps jamming. Just keep those chords going. Hey, how you feeling out there? Many thanks to everybody joining in. Kuselnik, I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly. Kuselnik, thank you very much for your generous donation and your good vibes. I appreciate you all joining in. Now, friends, I love this riff, and I hope that you fall in love with it too. Now, here is your action item for this week, all right? Check out your D major scale, all that stuff that we were doing before. And then when you hang out with this lick, this riff, treat it the same way. Just be willing to monotask. Just do one thing, because the deeper you go into one thing, you will first of all, learn it and retain it longer. But second of all, you get better at the process of learning, right? Don't click away. Don't tap out. See what happens if you just hang with one thing and let more be revealed. This is what I mean. You hang with it first. Just get that down once. Notice how as you slow it down and you're willing to go slow, you may notice some cool subtleties. Right here, there's a little silence. See, I'm just letting the chord shut off and then up. So in between the first and the second upstroke, if you let the chord mute, it helps out the rhythm. There's nothing wrong with doing it where they ring out, but listen to the difference. Let's compare them. Here's the first one. That may be the first step for you, and if so, awesome. Thanks for showing up and doing it. That's holding down the chord. But now, watch what happens when I add that mute. See how much more crisp the rhythm is? In that moment, my hand also gets a chance to relax. So please, friends, I hope that you'll be willing just to slow down, not only so you can learn it, but you can have a relaxed experience with learning. In between that up and that up, there's a total relaxation moment. And there's also a little bit of a mute at the end right here and at the end right here. And I put in a little bit of fo-bo-bo-bo. Totally optional, but this is the icing on the cake. You don't have to do that. You may like to start the riff out at the very beginning. Plain. And then just sneak some of those nuances in. Anyway, you know, you have your own experience with it. I'm just glad that you're here and you're willing to hang with your music. And I appreciate you hanging with me. I hope that you found this lesson helpful. Do Re Mi, right, by Rodgers and Hammerstein's hanging out with this bonus, bonus idea of getting together one scale, what that does for your hand, what that does for your music. It's very deep to go into one thing at a time. All right, so just trying to present things in a way that's accessible to the beginner, but also leveling up your skills. Also, you may like to hang out with the improv games, sound and silence, making phrases, repeating those phrases. So as we begin to jam, we're not just noodling, but we're really starting to compose our ideas. Hang with us a little bit each time you pick up your ukulele. Your hand's going to get stronger, and you're going to have a lot of fun, okay? Finally, Glory Days, go look at, you can find it on YouTube or on your Spotify, Glory Days by Bruce Springsteen. Now you have it in the original key. So if you jam out this tune with your jamming buddies, all right, your friends in your ukulele clubs, now you can have a nice riff. And even if you don't teach it to the rest of the group, you could start off the whole song with, you know, you could be up there starting out the whole tune with this riff. Friends, I thank you so much for joining me. Thank you very much for your continued generosity, your support of my work here at Ukulele Zen. I hope you and your families are doing well. Wishing you really, really good day. Lots of happy times jamming. Okay? Good health and much happiness to you. Peace and love until we meet again. Thank you so much.